Dr. Rasad Dhamani on avian biodiversity.
Thank you very much.
First of all, I want to thank Dr. Kohli for inviting me for this, and also INSA for inviting me for this talk, Dr. Sangvi and my friend Dr. Bhatt. I'm very grateful to them. I try to be on time, and so I'll put my watch here in front of me. So I'll be talking about the avian diversity and the emerging challenges. First, a small introduction about this. In India, we have got nearly 170 species of birds, which is quite a big number compared to many other countries. And even in the last 400 years, we have exterminated more than 180 species of birds. Globally threatened species, in total, there are nearly 11,000 species of birds in the world, and globally threatened species are nearly 1,100. And in India, we have got nearly 180 species which are listed by the IUCN under the red list. And we have lost two species like the pink-headed duck and the mountain quail. I don't think there is any chance for them to be rediscovered. Although there were used to be four species which were considered extinct at one time, but two have been rediscovered, like the turtle scouser and the verge of extinction are the great green custard and the white belly, the Jordan's coastal and the forest arbor for the three discovered. And these are the countries you can see that how rich we are. USA, which is nearly 3 times bigger than us, they have got only 900 species and we have got 1,270 species. But Brazil and Colombia have got the largest one. We also have many endemic species which are not found anywhere else in the world. We have got nearly 61 endemic species of which we are responsible, and if we don't take care of them, they will disappear. So we have, and some of the examples are the Jordan's coastal forest owlet painted partridge and the grey jungle fowl and Africa mountain. We also have nearly 100 species which are near endemic, where it means that nearly 90% of the population of those species is found in India. They occur in Nepal, they used to occur in Bangladesh, or they used to occur in Pakistan, or some occur in Sri Lanka, but 90%, like the great green custard is still, few examples are present in Pakistan, but 90% population is in India. Similarly, the long-billed vulture, again, almost 98% population is found in India. So endemic and near endemic species, we have got nearly 160 to 180 species. Texara strain is also very widely distributed, but again 98% population is found here. We know that well-known threats are the hunting and trapping and habitat destruction, bird rain, and habitat deterioration. Deterioration is also very important because as Dr. Bhatt said, that overgrazing is a huge problem almost all over the country. So grazing is not a problem, but overgrazing is a problem, and deteriorates the habitat of many ground nesting birds as well as many. So you can see the hunting still goes on in some parts of India and quite rampant. And these are the areas where the most of the threatened species of the world are found, but in forests. And the second are the savannas, which are neglected ecosystems. Like some taxa are neglected, similarly some ecosystems are also neglected, because we all talk of forest conservation, but no one gives attention to the grasslands, wetlands, and scrublands. So these are almost second habitat, which is very important to the world. There are not many studies in India which have a long-term population monitoring, but recently there was a paper that nearly 3 billion birds are missing in America. And possibly the same thing is happening in India, but we don't have the information. So common species, which we used to consider as common species, are not any common anymore. Like simply like the drongo or the Indian roller, which particularly the insectivorous species are becoming extremely uncommon all over India. So possibly if we do some detailist monitoring, then we will also find that nearly millions of birds are missing. This is the data of critically extinct and endangered species of India, which is not a very good situation. There are five major reasons why some of the birds become the rare. Like one of the major reasons is, I'm not going into detail, but the slow, long-living and slow-breeding birds. There are many species like storks, egrets, large eagles, which are slow-breeding, and they live in very low density, and they are disappearing from different parts of India, because most of the people don't even know that, because it's not very dramatic when they disappear. One pair disappears there, one pair disappears there, from one pair disappears there. Then we have got the specialist species, which are habitat specialists or behavioral specialists, like the Swamp Franklin or the Bengal Franklin. They live in a particular type of grassland. They can't live anywhere else, like the Tarai grasslands. Similarly, the hornbills. Hornbills need old growth forest. And earlier, a few years ago, old growth forests were removed by the forest department because they think that they will spread the disease. So if you remove the old trees, the hornbills also disappear. So these are the habitat specialists. Then we have got the island habitat specialists, like Narkunda hornbill, which I worked for some weeks there. It is found only 7 square kilometer area in the whole world. It has got the shortest or smallest distribution range of any bird in India. So if something happens to Narkunda island, the bird will be in trouble. But fortunately, at present, the bird is doing very well. SACON has done a study, and I also went there, then we saw quite a number of them. But it is always at a risk. Then the colonial breeders are also in a huge risk, like terns, threading holes, and skimmers, and BNHS and other organizations are doing it. Particularly, the birds which live in the breed on the rivers. Then the migratory species, because migratory species, I'll show some slides, and the migratory species needs collaboration and cooperation from in different countries all over the world. I'll just give an example of the Bengal frog, which is found, which I consider the king of the avian king of the grasslands. It is found probably less than 1,000 are surviving in the whole world. I have been monitoring the Bengal frog for almost 35 years, and from Dudhwa, there is 50% decline of the Bengal frog, despite the fact that the habitat is still, because most of the time they go outside, and the first almost 6-7 months they are outside, and we do not know what happened there. So this is, and you see the distribution of the Bengal frog in Brahmaputra Valley, which we did a study funded by the Ministry of Environment and Forest, and we found that they are found only in 6 or 7 sites. So Bengal falcon is still a good flyer, so it can move from one habitat to another. But there are many species, some species which are very weak flyer. They cannot fly from one habitat to another. There is a very interesting bird, black-crested parrotbill. In the olden record, that it is found that it is old. If you see the books, they say the Salimali's book, they say that it is found in the Brahmaputra floodplains. Brahmaputra floodplains are 700 kilometer long. So you will feel, oh, wonderful, Brahmaputra floodplain. But when you start doing the actual work, which I did three years ago, we found that it is found only in 5 or 6 sites. And some of the sites are nearly 200 kilometers from each other. It is a weak flyer. So how will it colonize? How will it grow? So these are all issues of the birds, which are like the distribution, and as I said, that old reports distribution is now outdated. And we have to do more studies to find out what is the distribution. And not only the distribution, even if the habitat is present, how much it is occupied by a particular species. So we need this sort of studies to do. A major threat, which are, I would say, wind farms, power line pollution, free-ranging stray dogs, and climate change and others. These are the huge threats which are beside the habitat destruction. There are some birds like storks and cranes, which have got the visual block in front of them, because the eyes are on this side, they have a big bill, so they can't see in the front. So when they are flying fast, before they can see a wire, they hit the wire. So the huge problem for birds like, and these are the birds which are slow breeders, and they live in low density. So the adult mortality, if the adult mortality takes place, then the population declines very fast. And you can see this great cluster. Nearly the Wildlife Institute of India has done wonderful work on the great wing bustard, and they are doing it, and they found that on an average 18 birds die every year after eating the wire. And how many birds are left? probably 120 to 130 birds. So we have got only 5 or 6 years, 7 years for the, before the bird becomes extinct, if the conditions go on so well. I did a study on the Zara strain. There also I found a huge, not a huge decline, but quite a number of Zara strains hitting the wire at a time in 2 years of history or a small area. The stray dogs are, I call them the new exterminators. They are the new exterminators. They are the huge problem all over the country. I love dogs, but I certainly don't like stray dogs moving around and killing our wildlife. And you can see that they are everywhere. You can, there are wonderful papers coming up from Indian scientists also on the stray dog. There are called 1 billion stray dogs or free-ranging stray dogs. This is a black-neck crane. There we have got 15 to 16 pairs breeding in Ladakh, and 50% of the chicks are eaten by the stray dogs. So where do we need the black-neck crane chicks or the stray dogs? This is a question which we have to ask from the people who fight for the stray dogs. I also found that huge the stray dogs are a huge problem for Saras crane and the great muscle. And dogs present, there are studies, and I would like researchers to do more studies in India. There are studies which show that the mere the presence of the stray dogs decreases the population of density of some birds because they leave that area. And I have seen it when the stray dog is there, the Saras leaves the area. But where will they go? There are stray dogs everywhere. So there is probably a decline in the unwanted IS. Professor Kohli has already spoken, so I want to speak on this. Threat of the climate change. For migratory birds, the biggest threat is the climate change. And there are wonderful studies coming up that which shows that most of the birds will be, many of the migratory birds will be impacted by that. Longer flights, greater danger. To show that birds' distribution will shift due to climate change, and they have to fly much, much longer than they do it, and they have got a very delicate energy balance when they are flying. And I'll show you a very interesting thing. In the migratory birds, these sites are also important. Stopover sites are also important. This is a Hobara migration studied by the satellite tracking instrument. And then there are many birds, and the researches are coming up that many species have to fly much more than they can do now. But they don't have that energy to fly that much. So probably many birds are dying on the way. And the stray by migratory birds are too exhausted to mate. It came in the newspaper, and I saw the research paper also. You can read it that they show that by the time they reach the breeding area, they are too exhausted to even mate. So the breeding is also impacted by that. This is a very interesting study, which is every year the golden plover migrates non-stop from Alaska to Hawaii for 4,000 kilometers. Flies continually on frequency for 88 hours. It needs 80 gram of fat to fly the distance, but it has got only 70 grams of fat. So how does it fly? It flies in V formation. So in the V formation, you know that they save the energy of each other. So what I wanted to say is that there is a very delicate energy balance of these birds. And there is a recent study which came out just 5 days ago that those many migratory birds are also decreasing in the size. And possibly this is adaptation. I'll go very quickly. Artificial lights, which we have not done studies on this. Then tall glass buildings, which again, not many studies have been done in India. Possibly it is not a big problem in India. Hunting is still a problem. We have to control hunting all over.
Slow down. Hello. Sorry. You're going to slice too fast. You can't.
There are very few.
That's an interesting topic.
Bird pain is still a huge issue. This is a recent photograph I got in 12 days ago. It's not that we have, it is out of view. And I'll take two minutes on this. Mining and boulder mining is a huge problem. This problem is moving to the Indian subcontinent, possibly it's found in other places. Also, there are species like Indian skimmer, which is a globally threatened species, vulnerable species. And when it breeds, there's a huge mining. This is all illegal. This is taken in Chambal River and all illegal, but many chicks are disturbed and destroyed by the cattle which move there. So there are all and plastic pollution. You can see that It is a huge problem in the particularly for the many species. And I also found that in Sara strain also, and there was a study in Bhutan that the blackneck crane also had the plastic in their feces. So we have to see what can be done to use good science-based conservation action, because the Ministry of Environment Forest, I was in the committee for many years, they always say, where is the science? But our problem is, where is the permission? But sir, where is the permission? You are a scientist, you can give permission. Permission is the biggest problem for Indian researchers, wildlife researchers. So that's why we have got a very good institute, Wildlife Institute of India, SICOM, BNHS, ETRI, many institutes, but biggest problem is permission. So we have to solve this permission to get good information about the Indian birds, not only Indian birds, but also Indian wildlife. Then these are some of the things which I have recommended. Thank you very much. I think I have time.